Well, thank you for joining us once again. Welcome to Grace. As we begin moving through, or as we began, I should say, moving through Paul's epistles in chronological order, not the order they're in your Bible, but the order in which he wrote them, we discovered that his first three letters were written in the order of the three things that our apostle said remain today: faith, hope, and what was the last one? Love. So we talked about how each believer's spiritual maturity is directly tied to that believer's understanding, appreciation, and actually application of the doctrines Paul sets forth in regard to those three doctrinal realms. And you can see them there as Paul wrote them. Galatians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians was hope. Galatians was faith. 1 and 2 Corinthians is love. The spiritual growth of those who have believed the gospel of Christ is important, not only because our spiritual maturity directly impacts how we relate to one another as fellow members of the body of Christ, but also, as we've been saying, because every believer's work of faith, patience of hope, and labor of love will be evaluated at the judgment seat of Christ as we will stand there, and God will know. Christ will know. He'll be the judge at that judgment, and we'll either be found worthy of reward or we'll stand there suffering the loss of reward, according to the Apostle Paul. As our Apostle stated in his second letter to the assembly at Corinth in chapter 5, verse 10, here it is: for we must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Now, we learned that the Greek word translated good in this passage has to do with being beneficial, where meriting reward is concerned. It's not good things, bad things, where sin is concerned. And that the word translated bad means worthless. It means of no value whatsoever at the judgment seat of Christ where it comes to being reward worthy. It was only fitting that Paul remind these saints in Corinth of the judgment seat of Christ because of all the assemblies to which Paul would visit and then write. The saints in Corinth were the most carnal or fleshly-minded bunch of believers that Paul would encounter throughout his apostolic journeys. No assembly was more carnal than Corinth. The saints in Corinth could only think of themselves. We know things that were going on there that were horrible things. They were bent on satisfying the lusts of the flesh, the lust of their eyes, and we know that they were spiritually immature because we learn from Paul's letters that the pride of life was the dominating player when it came to those self-serving saints. Some commentators say the church, the professing church today, is most like Corinth than in any other of any of the other assemblies that Paul wrote to. But self always came first with the people in the Corinthian assembly. Now, we spent considerable time looking at aspects number one and number two of the judgment seat of Christ, those being our work of faith and our patience of hope. So now we've come to the judgment seat of Christ, issue number three, our labor of love. And this is what we'll be considering in our lessons ahead. As I said earlier, agape love is the capstone when it comes to spiritual maturity. It's the epitome of spiritual maturity. This is where Paul's letters to the assembly in Corinth come into view, because the saints in Corinth epitomized the exact opposite of spiritual maturity. They exemplified what the Apostle Paul called carnality. So Paul's letters written back to Corinth were about love, because he couldn't teach them love doctrine, meat doctrine, when he was there with them, and he was with them there for 18 months. They were far too carnally minded for love doctrine. So Paul had to back up, and he had to stay with faith doctrine. As Paul stated in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2, for I determined not to know anything among you. He determined that by their carnality, their immaturity spiritually wise. I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul stuck with faith doctrine because that's the foundation. Jesus Christ and him crucified is faith doctrine. And faith doctrine is the foundation upon which doctrines concerning the believer's hope and doctrine concerning the believer's love is based. You have to have that faith doctrine first. So Paul went all the way back to the beginning because they weren't ready for any other doctrine. He had to remain with faith doctrine with the carnal Corinthians because the saints in Corinth were not sufficiently spiritually mature, we might say, to digest the meat doctrines concerning agape love. Watch Paul admonish these carnal Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, meaning spiritually mature, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able. How would you like the Apostle Paul to walk in, stand up, and say something to you like that? You're not able, you weren't able then, you're not able now. It's important to note at the outset of our study on the believer's labor of love that it wasn't a matter of a lack of knowledge at Corinth. And it was the fact that their knowledge had worked to puff them up rather than to grow them up. Listen to what Paul told them at the outset of his first letter, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 4 through 7. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ. They certainly hadn't merited it, so that word grace really fits exceptionally well there with this bunch and with us as well. That in everything ye are enriched by him, in all utterance, and catch this, and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. These folks had been enriched, according to Paul, in all utterance and in all knowledge. Paul reminded them of that. In other words, Christ was confirming Paul's message through these believers at Corinth by way of the supernatural sign gifts that he had bestowed upon these carnal believers. The utterance spoken of here had to do with that supernatural gift of being able to speak in languages that these folks had never learned. This would have been of great benefit when you think about it, to the unbelieving Jews of that day, Jews who had been born under the law contract, who were living in the outlying regions during the time of Paul's three journeys, and where languages had been different from the language spoken by the folks in Corinth. And I would have, this would have worked equally as well for the unbelieving Gentiles of that day, who were of different language groups at that time. Let me illustrate what I'm talking about as we consider a map of the Middle East for just a moment. According to the linguist list, 88 languages have been found in Iran. Isn't that interesting? 31 in Iraq, 72 in Turkey, 55 in Israel, and 24 in Syria. So it's fairly easy to see what migration has brought about since the confounding of the common tongue at the Tower of Babel. Back in the Old Testament days, the four major languages spoken in the Middle East were Latin, Greek, Aramaic, and Hebrew. But of course, there were numerous other languages and dialects, different dialects spoken, which we'll be seeing in just a few moments. A great example of speaking in an unknown tongue, meaning an unknown language, in Old Testament times is found in the book of Isaiah in connection with Israel and their fierce opponent, who knows who that might have been, Assyria, I should say. The northern kingdom Israel would eventually go into Assyrian captivity, as we learned in earlier lessons, but notice what happened before that captivity took place. A king named Hezekiah, one of the good kings of the nation, was on the throne reigning over the southern kingdom Judah when the king of Assyria sent an envoy to warn King Hezekiah's representatives, his envoys, not to trust King Hezekiah that the Lord would deliver them from the armies of Assyria. The envoy from the king of Syria was boasting and threatening the representatives of King Hezekiah. Their meeting took place just outside the walls of Jerusalem in the southern kingdom's capital city. But as was often the case, there were men on the walls there, listening in, sitting on the walls, and they would have been within earshot of what was being said and the threats that were being leveled against the southern kingdom by that representative of Assyria. So King Hezekiah's messengers were worried that those eavesdropping men on the wall, men from Judah, might become demoralized by the boasts and the threats of that Assyrian envoy. And they didn't want that to happen. So notice how they attempted to handle the situation as the story unfolds in Isaiah chapter 36, verse 11. Then said Eliakim, and I'm going to pronounce these as they look rather than the proper pronunciation. Then said Eliakim and Shebna and Joah, King Hezekiah's men, unto Rabshakeh, that the chief representative, that just means chief envoy, chief representative, from the king of Assyria. Speak, I pray thee, unto thy servants, the men from Hezekiah, in the Syrian language, for we understand it. And speak not to us in the Jews' language, in the ears of the people that are on the wall. You see what they were saying? You see the plan that they had set? If the people from our own kingdom, who are eavesdropping, are not capable of understanding you guys, they won't become disheartened. Now, they didn't tell them that, but that was the idea in their minds. And they won't spread their dismay and concern to the rest of the people of Judah, demoralizing them as well. So speak, we understand you. So they told the Assyrian spokesman, you can talk to us in your own language, the Syrian language, because we're able to understand what you're talking about. But don't speak to us in Hebrew, the language of those others who are listening in. There's no need for that. And so it was a pretty wise plan, but did it work on the king of Assyria? No, or the representative? No. He kept speaking to them in the Hebrew language. Now fast forward to the day of Pentecost, some 750 years later, when the 12 apostles of the nation Israel were in the upper room, and God supernaturally gifted them with the ability to speak in languages they had never learned. That event takes place in Acts chapter 2, verses 4 through 12. Beginning with Acts chapter 2, verse 4, we read, and they, the 12, were all filled or controlled by the Holy Ghost. And they began to speak with other tongues, other languages, as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, why would the 12 apostles need to be able to speak in different languages on that high holy feast, Jewish feast day called Pentecost? Languages they had never previously learned. The remainder of the passage provides the answer. Notice now verses 5 through 8. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men. They were there for that feast day. They were dwelling there temporarily dwelling there for that feast day. Devout men out of every nation under heaven. These were Jewish people. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together. And they were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. Let's continue the story with verses 7 and 8. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how do we hear every man in our own language where we were born? How many different languages might we be talking about here in this case? It took three verses, beginning with verse 9, to list all of the areas that where different languages might very well have been spoken during that time. Follow the list. Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia, in Pontus, in Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia in Egypt, and in the parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes to Judaism. He goes on in verse 11 to say, Cretes and Arabians, a total of 14 different regions listed there, folks. We do hear them speak in our tongues, plural, in our languages, the wonderful works of God. So God made sure, through this supernatural gift of being able to speak in languages the speakers had never learned, and he did that at Pentecost, those speakers had never been taught those languages, that the message he wanted delivered to those Jews who had been born under that law contract could be understood in the language those Jews spoke, and proselytes to Judaism, as we said a few moments ago, who needed to hear that message. Such was the case during the time of Paul's three journeys. So such was the case in Corinth. God made sure that every Jew and proselyte to Judaism that had been born under that law contract could hear the message. As many of you know, the believers of the gospel of God at Corinth began meeting in a house that joined hard to the synagogue. Now there's some understanding we can gain from that expression. This tells us that there was only one wall separating the two groups. It'd be as though there was another group right behind this wall here. And if you remember the days in the old building, we had the young people meeting right behind us with one wall between us. And sometimes, while the congregation might not have heard it, I was hearing everything that was going on. I was just thankful they were having a great time. But this was the case. There were two different groups. The unbelieving religious Jews and proselytes to Judaism on one side of the wall, and there were those Jews, along with Gentiles, who had chosen to believe Paul's gospel on the other side of the wall. Who do you suppose could hear what was going on in that assembly at Corinth where the supernatural gift of speaking in foreign languages was being exercised? The answer is the unbelieving Jews on the other side of the wall. They could hear what was being said. Who do you suppose had known that would be occurring? God had known that would happen all along. That's one of the reasons why some of those saints in Corinth had been gifted as they had been gifted. And this is why the Apostle Paul wrote what he did in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 22. Wherefore, tongues are for a sign not to them that believe. They have nothing to do with you, the believers, but to them that believe not. Who were those who believed not? Those on the other side of the wall, the Jewish folks who refused to take God at his word through Paul. But prophesying, proclaiming truth, serveth not for them that believe not, but for them which believe. And that was prophesying within the assembly. Now, there's a good point to be made right there, and just came to my mind. Prophesying or proclaiming truth serveth not for them that believe not. Where? In the assembly. Yet today, we proclaim the gospel almost every week. No matter who's in the assembly, because somebody's going to pop in that may not have heard the message of reconciliation. In that day, it was believers that came in. Those who knew the message took the message out and brought those people that knew the message and believed it, the word of reconciliation, into the assembly where they could grow spiritually. So tongues were for a sign to unbelievers, and those unbelievers were right behind the wall. Now, you might think that being supernaturally gifted in such a miraculous manner, and knowing that this supernatural utterance, as it's called, this utterance phenomenon, had not been something they had merited, they hadn't worked for it, they didn't deserve it, hadn't come by any effort at all on the folks in Corinth. We know that because look at their carnality. But it had come solely as a gift from God, and you would think that would have humbled those who had been gifted in such a manner. But that's not the way the sin nature works in man, is it? That's not how the pride of life operates. Paul told the saints in Corinth that they had come behind in no gift. We just read that a moment ago. In other words, no group of saints had been as carnal, but likewise, no group of saints had been supernaturally gifted in such an all-encompassing manner as had the carnal saints in Corinth. Now, Paul told them that in everything ye are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. So it wasn't a lack of ability, nor was it a lack of knowledge that had stunted the growth of these carnal Corinthians. It was the presence of undue pride that had worked to undermine their spiritual development. Those with the more observable gifts were holding themselves up above others who had not been gifted in that same manner. Believers were bringing lawsuits against believers in that assembly. Divisions were rampant, gross immorality taking place. Divisions is the key word here, were rampant in the Corinthian assembly. And attached to that word division is always another word, alienation. Divisions, alienations, attached at the hip, we might say. Now think about that for a moment. Did Satan not know the best strategy when it came to a battle plan against God and God's people? You see, while God works through his written word to accomplish his purpose with his people, that purpose being spiritual growth, by the way, if they're his people, Satan had set his plan in motion in the garden in order to defy God's purpose and to accomplish his own purpose with whom? With God's people. We might call that strategy his divide and conquer strategy. You've heard of that. Undue pride always results in division and separation. Listen to Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 3. For ye are yet carnal. You remain carnal. I've been with you for a year and a half, and you're still carnal. For whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men? The word carnal means fleshly-minded, fleshly-oriented, fleshly-bent. Where there's fleshly orientation, folks, there's always envy, strife, and divisions. You can count on it. Why, of course, these saints were fleshly-focused. Their conduct proved their carnality. The Greek word translated divisions, by the way, dikastasia, means disunion and dissension. Do you recognize an English word that might very well have come from the Greek dikastasia? Anyone recognize a word there? Look it on the overhead. How about the word dichotomy? Can you see that in dikastasia? Dichotomy, which is defined. How about that word dichotomy defined by these terms in a dictionary of the English language? Opposition, contradiction, separation, clash. You see the connection? All of these terms characterize the assembly at Corinth because there were divisions in the Corinthian assembly. Any good marshal of the battlefield knows that divide and conquer is an excellent battle strategy when it comes to defeating or demoralizing an enemy. You can get the opposing army to become divided such that communications channels break down, and if that's the case, you have a much better or much higher possibility of success. If you can cause some of them to actually turn against others of them in this within that same group, you have an excellent chance of victory. The principle of divide and conquer, anyone know where that came from? Well, it was spelled out by Jesus Christ in Mark chapter 3, verse 25, where Christ said, "And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand." So divide and conquer. Satan knew the truth of that statement from Christ, and he knew it quite well. This is the strategy that he consistently employed in his attempt to defeat God. He successfully employed it against Adam and Eve in the garden. We don't read where Satan approached them as a couple, do we? What did Satan do? Well, Satan caught Eve when she was all by herself. And then he planted the seeds of doubt and discontentment in the mind of the first woman. As a result, Eve convinced Adam, and the division was created, a division between God and man. That division formed what I've called the alienation sin wall. But like any seasoned warrior, Satan chose not to attack on only one front. His first attack was aimed at vertical alienation. Vertical alienation between Adam and God was true in Adam's mind as soon as he rebelled against God's direction not to eat from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Adam knew that he had disobeyed his Creator. So what did Adam do when he heard God speak to him there in the garden? He was afraid, the Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 3, and he ran and hid himself from the one who had formed him. So Adam knew, in Adam's mind, there was alienation between he and God. Adam had a sense of that alienation, and he had that sense of alienation the instant he heard God's voice. He ran to hide himself. Simply proved that he felt that alienation. Since Christ took the sins of the world upon himself at Calvary, dying on man's kind behalf, thus paying the price necessary to satisfy the Father's justice where the sins of the world are concerned, and then rose again victorious in what he had come to do. And what was that? Take away sin by the sacrifice of himself. The alienation sin wall between God and man no longer exists in God's mind. Christ removed the alienation sin wall at Calvary. He reconciled the world unto himself through that Calvary cross work, according to the Apostle Paul. If you've heard me speak at least once, you know the passage that's been the focal point of my ministry. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 18 through 21, where Paul tells us that God was in Christ, reconciling the entire world unto himself, not imputing or counting their trespasses unto them, and he's committed unto us that word of reconciliation. I encourage you to mark that passage in your Bible and take God at his word where these verses are concerned. The gospel of Christ tells us that it's impossible for Satan to keep the alienation sin wall standing between God and man. Because Christ reconciled the world unto God at Calvary, their sins are not being counted against them because God counted the sins of the world against his Son. But do you suppose that would stop Satan when it came to his divide and conquer strategy? If Satan can't keep man alienated from God in God's mind, because Satan cannot influence God's mind where the accomplishment of Calvary cross work of his Son is concerned, then whose minds do you suppose Satan would be most interested in influencing today? Well, it should become quite obvious. The answer is in men's minds, not in God's. God knows what his Son did. It's man that Satan is interested in reaching mind-wise. So this would not be something that Satan would let up on. He's trying to confuse people today as to the message of reconciliation. Satan would love to keep us, or mankind, enemies in their minds. Not in God's mind, but in theirs. That's not God to man alienation, folks. That's man to God alienation. And that's the vertical alienation that I've been talking about. It's man that's alienated, not God. But as I've been saying, Satan didn't stop there with his divide and conquer strategy. Satan's other direction is horizontal alienation. That's where he's working with divide and conquer today. I'm convinced that most of you know what I'm referring to here when I say horizontal alienation. Satan knows that united we stand, and what's the rest of that passage, or that saying? Divided we fall. A house divided principle that was relayed by Jesus Christ. When it comes to a local assembly of believers, for instance, those who are joined to Christ, saved and sealed saints, Satan knows that a divided assembly is a weak and ineffective assembly. A house divided cannot stand. So Satan works through the pride of life mindset of fallen mankind to divide man from man. In other words, horizontal alienation. We shouldn't be surprised at that. Satan's rebellion came as a result of his own pride. So Satan's weapon of choice since the days of the garden has been pride. And you need to understand the type of pride that we're talking about here. Not just all pride. Some pride is okay. But we're talking about pride, a pride that doesn't elevate self is okay. But I'm talking about pride in the sense of self-absorption that comes as a result of man's inherited sin bent to elevate himself above others. Elevation of self, we might call it self-aggrandizement, self-glorification, being absorbed with self for the purpose of self-elevation that will purportedly bring self-satisfaction, is the idea behind the pride we're talking about. Keep in mind that Satan tempted Eve with the notion that she and Adam could be as, what's the rest? As gods. Do you see the idea of elevating that Satan instilled in her mind? This was an elevation of self in relation to another. That was an elevation of self in relation to the one true God. You'll be as gods. It's obvious that Satan's battle strategy in the garden was to divide and conquer. His battle strategy was to divide man from God to create an alienation wall between the two. All Satan had to do in his deception of Eve, and this is interesting, was to instill in her mind that self-glorification idea. And what did Eve do? She ran with that ball as fast as she could run. She was headed to the goalpost and nothing was going to stand in her way. Not even the man from whom she had been fashioned, although there was no attempt on Adam's part to thwart Eve's efforts. He went right along with Eve, and he did so quite willingly, and he knew better, the Bible tells us. There was no hesitation in Eve's mind when it came to self-elevation. In Satan's chess game with God, if we want to think of it in that manner for a moment, Satan had made his initial move by instilling a mindset. And that one move would play itself out over and over again as Adam's offspring would inherit that very same elevation of self mindset in regard to others. And this is what we learn from the Apostle Paul, and what did Paul call it? The pride of life. I think it's important to take note of the avenue that Satan used to in his connection with the godlike status that he was offering Eve. He used some tactics that he knew would work. How could she achieve that equivalent to God status that Satan was promising her? How could she elevate herself in that regard? She could do so by satisfying the lusts of her flesh and the lusts of her eyes. How had Satan made it? How easy had Satan made it, we should say? Eve perceived that the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil was good for food, the Bible tells us. In other words, from Eve's perspective, the forbidden fruit would be useful when it came to satisfying the desires of her flesh. Her flesh was lusting after that fruit, whatever it may have been, because of the elevated status that she had been told she could gain from eating that fruit. Satisfy that desire was the essence of what Satan was telling her, and watch the elevation of self that will come as a result of that desire. Eve had only to eat the fruit. The Bible goes on to tell us that Eve found that fruit was pleasant to the eyes. In other words, if she would simply satisfy the lusts of her eyes, that godlike stature would belong to her. Tell me, do you people suppose that satisfying the lusts of the flesh and the lusts of the eyes is attached to, in men's minds, to an elevating themselves in the minds of others around them? That's exactly the case. Look at all the avenues through which we attempt at at the elevation of self in regard to others and how that takes place today. We do it through appearance. We do it through achievement or accomplishment. We do it through the attainment of wealth. What part of the flesh is opposed to any of that? We do it through the acquisition of possessions. We do it through a whole lot of things today. If you don't think we do it through an acquisition of possessions, take a look at all the storage rooms you'll pass as you drive down the highway. They're everywhere. And we're learning that you can pay way more over a short period of time for that storage room than all the stuff in there is worth. So we do it in a whole lot of ways today. We try to influence what others think of us. We want them to think of us in a certain way, and we try to influence that in certain other ways. I'm sure you can come up with your own lists. The Corinthians elevated themselves above others in their own minds. This took place in their minds through the supernatural gifts that they had reasoned placed them on a higher level, a higher plane, a higher level spiritually speaking than others in that same fellowship. Would you say they were spiritually mature? Obviously not. They were the exact opposite of being spiritually mature, according to Paul. They were immature babies, Paul called them. Immature babies, spiritually speaking, which made them immature babies behavioral-wise as well. Their elevated sense of self had brought alienation between them and those around them. And so now you get a flavor of what was happening in that Corinthian assembly. They were light years ahead. Those gifted in the observable ways, like the tongue speaking, the miracle workers, they were light years ahead, at least as they reasoned it, from their fellow saints in the same assembly. But carnality hasn't been something limited to the saints in Corinth, has it? The truth is that men have been elevating themselves in their own minds above others since the days of Adam's rebellion, and this results in the horizontal alienation I spoke of earlier. According to the Apostle Paul, this is the roadblock that stands in the way of the spiritual growth of those who believe the gospel of Christ. It's the pride of life. This is what had stunted the spiritual growth of the saints in Corinth, according to our apostle. They were self-oriented, self-focused, self-centered saints. So they were placing themselves in their own minds, once again, above others. Little wonder it affected their relationships with those around them. This is what kept them from arriving at what Paul would later call the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, which is directly related to every believer's labor of love, a facet of every believer's evaluation at the judgment seat of Christ. How did Paul know that the saved and sealed saints were spiritually immature, that they were babies? He recognized the symptoms. He could diagnose their condition quite quickly because Paul knew the symptoms that spiritual immaturity produces. Watch him address the two major symptoms of spiritual immaturity in his first letter to Corinth in chapter 1, verses 10 and 11. First, verse 10, and by the way, this is the test of spiritual maturity of the believers in any assembly. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be," here it is, "no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment." The word division there in verse 10 is the Greek schisma. Now, you recognize the English term we get from the Greek schisma, do you not? It's simply a transliteration in the English to schism. The Greek schisma is defined as a gap or a separation. We might call it alienation. We see that same word schisma in Matthew chapter 9, verse 16. Let's take a quick look at what Christ was saying here. Christ was speaking, and seeing if you can spot that word translated from the Greek schisma. Because they didn't use schisma and they didn't use schism, they translated it into a different word here in Matthew 9:16. "No man putteth a piece of new cloth unto an old garment. For that which it is put in to fill it up, taketh from the garment, and the rent is made." The old garment's not going to hold together. You attach a new piece to it, and the new piece is going to be torn from the old piece. The word the translators chose for the word schisma was the word rent, and I'm sure some of you probably figured that out. Here, schisma was used in reference to an actual physical tear. So we know there was a physical tear that took place there, and it caused that separation, one part being physically separated from the other. But the word schisma is also used in John chapter 7, verse 33, where a different type of separation can be seen. Let's quickly visit that passage, and we'll back up to include verses 41 and 42. Some were saying that Christ was simply a prophet and nothing more. Notice verse 41. Others said, this is the Christ. But some said, shall Christ come out of Galilee? Hath not the scripture said that Christ cometh of the seed of David and out of the town of Bethlehem, where David was? So there was a division among the people because of what was being spoken of Christ. In this case, the division was that of opinion rather than that of physical separation. There were those who were of a different opinion from others in the group. This wasn't a physical separation, as was the case in the Matthew passage, but rather an alienation that occurred in the department of what some might call feeling. This was an inward separation relative to belief or attitude. When Paul spoke of the divisions in Corinth, he was referring to divisions of mind. They were in the same group. Divisions of mind, divisions of thought. Some presumed they were on a higher spiritual plane than others in the group. So in that sense, they had placed themselves above other fellow members of that same assembly, co-members of the body of Christ. After talking about the division in Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, Paul went on to use a different word and a similar expression in verse 11, where he spoke of another symptom of carnality as opposed to spiritual maturity. Notice the words he used here. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe. Paul had received a letter, and he didn't hide the person that sent him the letter. He revealed the name, that there are contentions among you. Now, the first word was divisions. Now we see the word contentions. The Greek word behind the English word contention is eris, meaning a quarrel, wrangling, strife, and variance. Infighting is the idea wrapped up in all those Greek terms, Greek eris, rather. This is a degree beyond a difference of opinion. And as an added thought here, eris is the same Greek word Paul used in Romans chapter 1 when describing the mindset of the Gentiles that God had given over to their reprobate or unapproved thinking. Isn't that interesting? Let's read through that three-verse passage in Romans chapter 1 for a moment, verses 29 through 31, to get a better flavor, a better idea of that Greek word eris. And I want you to pay particular attention to the adverse effect that the behaviors Paul lists here would have on those who would have been subjected to such conduct. Beginning in verse 29, Paul wrote, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate. Now, the word translated debate is that word eris once again, which, as we discovered, means quarreling, wrangling, and variance. Do you see the division these behaviors would have brought between those guilty of such conduct and those who had been made the subjects of that conduct? Paul went on to say, he added deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, verse 31, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful. How would you like to be on the receiving end of that type of a conduct? The same word Paul used in connection with the unapproved Gentiles, prior to the establishment of the nation Israel, the word eris, translated debate, in verse 29, Paul used of the carnal saints in Corinth, and the assembly characterized by factions and divisions. It's interesting that the word translated contentions in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 11, is the same word translated debate in the Romans passage that we just read. You see how the translators use different words for the same Greek word? And in the Romans passage, where does that word appear? It appears right after murder and just before deceit. By the use of the word eris in connection with the saints in Corinth, their carnality becomes starkly more evident. It really stands out how carnal these folks really were. Paul was describing the works of the flesh in the Romans passage. He did the same in Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 and 20, where he was listing the works of the flesh. We needn't pull up that passage. You can look it up on your own. But in Galatians chapter 5, the word eris is translated strife. And Paul lists that word right after wrath and right before seditions. So eris was not a good term in the Greek, and that characterized the saints in Corinth. This lets us know the importance that God places on divisions and contentions as those words characterize the carnal saints in Corinth. not something God favored in any sense of the word. The reason why the carnality of the saints in Corinth was such a serious matter to our apostle is important, in fact, because these behaviors of the Corinthians were recorded forever. Paul listed them as babies, and that'll stand throughout history as the record of what characterized these saints. And Paul knew that Satan's game plan had been, has been, will always be, until he's thrown in the lake of fire, division. To divide and conquer from within has been his game plan all along. His first attack is to establish what I've called vertical alienation, man-Godward, not God-manward, man-Godward. His second area of attack is to create horizontal alienation, alienation between men, alienation man-to-man. And all of this is brought about by the me-first mindset that Paul called the pride of life, the mindset instilled of Eve when she was told she could be elevated to be as gods, her and Adam. That had its beginning with Adam's rebellion in the garden and subsequently inherited by every member of the human race thereafter. Since God's church, the household of faith, comprises all the believers in every assembly where Paul's gospel is being taught and believed, what better place where Satan was concerned, what better place to undermine God's spiritual temple called the body of Christ and the testimony coming from that building than to bring about division within that building? You see why this is an important issue? Can you see the seriousness of a failure to grow spiritually? Can you see how Paul's letter to Corinth, how that those letters, both of them, relate to the labor of love of these carnally minded saints, and how carnality is the exact opposite of spiritual maturity? Now, we should also know that every believer's labor of love will be such an important component of the judgment seat of Christ, where each believer will either stand worthy of reward or be ashamed and suffer the loss of reward. Did the Apostle Paul present a solution to those fleshly oriented, spiritually immature, carnal saints at Corinth? Yes, he did. And we find Paul's answer in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, where he makes this plea to this carnal bunch. Now I plead with you, I beseech you, brethren, we could read, I beg you, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. In the first part of this verse, Paul points to their outward testimony with his statement that ye all speak the same thing. So let's go there, but we'll go there first. When bickering, wrangling, contention and strife and vying for the superior position within the assembly, within the church, which is Christ's body, what does that say about the spiritual maturity of those believers? And more importantly, what adverse effect might that lack of spiritual maturity have on those who hear the message those immature saints claim they believe? A very important principle comes to mind here, and it's namely this: internal harmony is essential to outward effectiveness. What did Christ said earlier? He said, a house divided cannot stand. The fastest way to immobilize an army, as we've been saying all along, is to cause dissension within the ranks. This is the best way to demoralize any group, for that matter. A church divided is an ineffective church. And that goes when speaking of the body of Christ as a whole, or the body of Christ on the various local levels. A house divided cannot stand, and Satan knows that truth as well as anyone knows it. Many people think of church, quote unquote, as a social event, and to a large extent, that's become the case in the religious world. People are seeking friendships, and this is where they believe friendships with kind and loving people can most likely be found. So you see both small and large assemblies where people share a commonality on a social level. But this is also where friendships can go sour, is it not? Unless people are missing the pride of life mindset. And that's not the case. Reason it through. Did God intend that the true church, his body on local levels in this case, be places where people can divide into little groups or little factions, where common interests are shared, and where others with dissimilar interests might not really fit in to that small group? Or is the assembly of believers, from God's vantage point, to be a place where the warrior goes to be equipped and outfitted with the spiritual armor necessary for the battles that warrior, that saint's going to face from the world, the flesh, and Satan. If there's trouble in the fitting room, how can we believers hope for victory on the personal battlegrounds we're going to face in everyday life? Rather than the church equipping warriors in order that those warriors need not be tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, the pride principle is creating spiritual casualties as saints end up going to war with fellow saints. And isn't that a sad situation? Someone has said the Christian army is the only army that kills its wounded. What a church, quote unquote again, attendees usually do when they tire of the conflict in a particular location? Why, they simply search out another church in hopes that the pride nature won't be operating on the same level in the newfound church home. Of course, what did they bring into that new assembly when they entered the doors? The answer is they brought their own pride nature right along with them. So the pride of life is alive and well, and it's operating on some level in every member of humanity. Someone said, would the church not be a wonderful place if we could find a way to rid the church of all the people we don't necessarily care for that are within that church, within that assembly? You might be familiar with an old poem or one of its numerous variations. It goes something like this. To dwell above with saints we love, that'll be pure glory. But to live below with saints we know, now that's another story. I said, wow, that's some kind of truth in there, isn't there? When we lose the purpose of our outward ministry as an assembly, the testimony we have outward, we become ingrown. And there are ingrown assemblies, believe it or not, where newcomers aren't really welcome at all. I've run across some of those in my traveling. What are they trying to protect? What are those folks trying to protect? Well, they're trying to protect their assembly from becoming its own battleground. We'll simply confine our assembly to those of us who are already our friends, those of us who really, we really like one another, and we'll have nothing to worry about. That might sound safe on the surface, but an ingrown church is just as ineffective as far as the outward message Paul would have us to be spreading as an assembly where divisions characterize the group and infighting is the order of the day. God wants unity in the body of Christ. Paul's plea to the carnal saints at Corinth was that they all speak the same thing and that they be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Does this mean that no person in an assembly can differ from another person in that assembly when it comes to a particular doctrinal position? Certainly there are some doctrinal hills worth dying on, and some are not. But I don't believe that's what Paul has here in mind at all. In his statement about same-mindedness and same judgment, that's not what he's talking about. Don't differ on any doctrinal position. I believe he was talking about the same single-mindedness he had in mind when he later wrote Philippians chapter 2 and verse 2. Here it is. Fulfill ye my joy that ye be like-minded, the very same terminology he used in connection with the carnal saints in Corinth, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. How is it possible to be perfectly joined in the same mind, in the same judgment, when you have different people coming together with different backgrounds and differing interests? Paul answered that question as well just three verses later in the same letter to the saints at Philippi. Notice his exhortation in verses 5 through 7. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. How do we view those around us? Do we see those folks as though they are there to fulfill our needs, our need for unconditional love, our need for unconditional acceptance, and our need for unconditional forgiveness? Do we view them as though they are there to fulfill our need for friendship, with the problem being they don't always measure up? Or do we view them as though they are there in order that we might fulfill their needs in those same very same areas, regardless of the flow in our direction? Just a thought. There's something very interesting sitting in Paul's exhortation to the carnal saints at Corinth that I want you to see. So we're going to revisit that passage. It's sitting in Paul's same mind, same judgment statement we read just a few moments ago. Let me show you what I'm talking about. You'll recall the passage. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. Follow closely as I read this. You know, I'm oftentimes reading something wrong just to see if you're on your toes. Follow me closely as I read the passage. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together, and of the same mind, and of the same judgment. Did I read it correctly? Not if you're following closely. It didn't say of the same mind and of the same judgment. I didn't say it as Paul wrote it. I altered it a bit. Paul was exhorting these puffed up, prideful saints to be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. In whose mind? And in whose judgment, we might ask? The answer is in Christ's mind and in Christ's judgment, just as Paul tells us in that very same letter, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. The only way for all believers to be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment would be for all believers to lay aside their self-serving fleshly interests where others are concerned and adopt Christ thinking. Christ who came to do what? He came to serve rather than to be served by others. When it comes to our relationships with others, that's the mindset we're to adopt. Do you see what Paul's telling us here? When we make decisions relative to our relationships with others based upon what seems right to us, we bring our own personal motives. We bring our own personal agendas into the arena of those relationships. Another way of saying the same thing is we paint the fulfillment of our own perceived needs into the picture of our relationships with other people. If we have nothing to gain from the relationships, what do? We scrap that relationship. If we have nothing to gain from a relationship, why entertain that relationship at all is how the carnal mindset of man reasons it. And when that's the case, we're looking at others through the lens of what we might gain from those folks rather than what we might be able to provide for those people. If we were all perfectly joined together in the mindset of our Savior, there to serve rather than to be served, we wouldn't have to worry about divisions and factions within the body of Christ, whether that be on a universal level or on local levels of assembly. According to the Apostle Paul, we have the mind of Christ because those very thoughts, as they relate to this dispensation, have been conveyed to us by the risen, ascended Lord of glory through the pen of the Apostle Paul, as he recorded the thinking of Christ in his epistles. In order to adopt the thinking of Christ, what do we have to do? We have to rid ourselves of self-serving mindset, self-serving thinking, stinking thinking, as a very dear friend has called it. We have to see ourselves as servants rather than as those deserving to be served in the sense of having our needs met in order to maintain a relationship. That isn't an easy thing to do when the pride of life is present and operating in a life. And the fact is, it's always present. I believe this is why the apostle used the wording he used in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. Notice the very first word in this sentence. What is it? Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Think of this verse in sense of a believer's labor of love for a moment. That word endeavor is a translation of the Greek spoudazo, which means to make a concerted effort, to give due diligence to. It's a work, which is why Paul called it the believer's labor of love. It takes a concerted effort on the part of the one who desires to follow Paul's exhortation concerning agape love, because agape love doesn't come naturally to the flesh. What's Paul saying there? What's he telling us? Is he asking believers to actually act unnaturally? Yes, he is. Go against your feelings, he's saying. This isn't something that's going to come natural to you. In fact, the flesh will do everything in its power to short-circuit what Paul's telling us we're to endeavor to do when it comes to the basis of our relationships with other folks, especially with those of the household of faith. Many a believer has come face to face, with spiritual growth disaster at the intersection of the pride of life and the mind of Christ. Let's allow Paul to take us a little further into this passage about having the mind of Christ in Philippians chapter 2. There are a couple additional verses we need to add at this point. Notice verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Tell me, that's easy to do. The word translated vainglory there means self-conceit, self-serving interests. It has to do with the desire of the flesh to be recognized and advanced in its own right. Is Paul telling us to put another person's interest first, even if those interests conflict with serving our own interests as the flesh views those interests? Keep reading. Look not every man on his own things, chapter 2, verse 4, but every man also on the things of others. Now couple that statement from Paul with his exhortation in Romans chapter 12, verse 10, where he said, be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, in honor doing what? In honor actually preferring one another. What a strange thought to the flesh. And in this very same letter to the saints at Rome, Paul went on to say, owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. We know we don't love properly because none of us fulfill the law. So we don't love properly because we have a throne in our lives and self is sitting on that throne. And there are a lot of selves out there competing for the same throne. Wow, Paul, you're making the spiritual maturity destination an awfully difficult place to arrive. Paul never said it would be easy, did he? And this isn't about salvation. This is about the judgment seat of Christ where our labor of love is concerned. In fact, Paul told us it would be the opposite of easy. That's why he used the words endeavoring and labor in connection with our labor of love. The pride of life and the labor of love are archenemies. Some people say archenemies. It makes no difference. The flesh will fight with everything it has to allow nothing to get in the way when it comes to advancing its own cause, fulfilling its own lusts. The flesh wants nothing at all to do with a labor of love unless the flesh sees reciprocation coming from those upon whom our labor of love is bestowed. The flesh must benefit. It must be the object of reciprocation, or the flesh will resist the effort of a labor of love. He'll resist it. The flesh will resist it at every turn. All right, we've already talked about how the proper exercise of agape love is the epitome of spiritual maturity. When Paul mentioned the three things that remain today, he said that of those three things, agape, a type of love, was the greatest of the three. In that sense, we might call the exercise of agape love the high calling of God in Jesus Christ for every believer of Paul's gospel. It's the high calling of God where spiritual maturity is concerned. Keep that high calling in mind for a moment. Do you remember Paul's words in Philippians chapter 2 where he talked about being like-minded and having the same love and about each esteeming other better than themselves? It's in Philippians where Paul told us to let this mind be in you which was in Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, and how Christ made of himself no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant rather than one desiring to be served. This is what agape love is all about, folks. After all, God is love, the Bible tells us. And the word is agape in both of those instances where we read God as love. Well, it's also in Philippians that Paul likened himself to a man running a race. Notice Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. A lot of times we dwell on those past events. And reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What might be the prize of the high calling of God be for the Apostle Paul? Well, I think we can count on the fact that the prize for which Paul had to do with being found reward worthy at the judgment seat of Christ is exactly what he's talking about. Paul knew that his work of faith, his patience of hope, and his labor of love would be the calling that he had, and he knew that his labor of love was the high calling where spiritual maturity is concerned. And he knew his would be evaluated for either reward or suffering the loss of reward. There's so many additional things we need to add at this point, but we're going to continue our journey through the Bible, and we'll continue with Paul's epistles, and we're going to continue with the believer's labor of love. We did a study some time ago that I entitled Grown-Up Gracers. Anyone here recall that story? I see a few heads nodding. That was 14 years ago when I looked it up. Isn't that amazing? Well, we're going to revisit that study in our upcoming lessons in connection with our study of the judgment seat of Christ and the believer's labor of love. I'll be enhancing that series this time around with some additional interesting information. So I hope you'll continue to follow along as we continue our journey through the Bible and our look at the epistles of the Apostle Paul.